China, home to 1 in 5 of the planet's population. The superpower the world fears, but few really know.
Ken Hom is the godfather of Chinese food.
Heaven on earth.
He introduced the wok to the West more than 30 years ago.
This is the way you should be cooking it.
Ching-He Huang is leading the next generation of Chinese cooks.
I'm just going to chop off the head.
With a modern, inventive approach to the cuisine.
It's like ducks playing in springtime.
Lovely.
We're taking a once-in-a-lifetime adventure across China through food.
Rabbit head.
Shall we try one?
To delve into its heart and soul.
Like it. Pull it. Food is the best way to explore Chinese culture because we really live to eat.
It's an epic trip. 3,000 miles from the megacities of the East to the forgotten villages of the Wild West.
It's like we've been back to the time of Genghis Khan.
She's just decapitated it.
We'll uncover the familiar, the secret, and the surprising.
Wow, I've never seen that done before.
Cook simple and delicious dishes.
That is my Sichuan sausage.
And reveal the secrets of China, old and new.
It's like a journey that I've always dreamt about, but in a China I've dreamt about.
This time we're in Chengdu. It is one of the fastest growing cities in the world. In the interior of the country, it's always been an isolated place, free from Western influence, and remains the most Chinese of China's megacities. Nearly 1,000 miles from Beijing, deep in the heartland, in Sichuan province, Chengdu is known as one of the culinary capitals of China. The food here is the hottest in China, and increasingly famous all over the world for its distinctive, fiery flavors.
Incredible variety, yes.
We've come to Chengdu Spice Market to explore the explosive tastes that make Sichuan food so unique.
This place is like the core, the heart, and the mothership of spicy Sichuan food.
The people here are obsessed with chilies, claiming they have a medicinal quality, driving out the cold, wet climate.
And you really feel like trying all of them because some of them I've never seen before.
I hope they're right because it really is damp here. Even the seeds of the chili, which we tend to avoid in the West, are sold here as a garnish.
They took the seeds out, the ones that are slightly off color, that aren't as desirable.
Oh my God.
So that's a lot of chili. They stir fry it. So it's dry toasting.
You would think this assault on their taste buds would be unbearable, but it's not all about chilies.
So big. Where do you start?
There's a second key ingredient that absolutely defines Sichuan food. This innocent-looking husk from the berry of the prickly ash bush is called the Sichuan flower pepper. It creates an incredibly intense numbing sensation that balances the chili heat of the food. It stimulates the taste buds, unleashing an explosion of flavors.
I don't know why I'm actually a little terrified of trying it, because I've cooked with it so many times.
Wow.
Normally,
you wouldn't eat this.
It's really strong, really numbing heat, much stronger than what we have in the UK.
It's these authentic local flavors that I've come here to cook with and master.
The fragrance of lavender taste is unbelievable.
I know, lavender and a little citrus spice to it.
I haven't been here for almost 24 years, and now I realize how much I just miss this fragrance.
There are not many places in the world where cooking is so dominated by just a few key spices. We want to begin our exploration of these fascinating complex flavors where some of the most authentic food can be found. Here in these ramshackle restaurants hidden away in the alleys and back streets of the city. To help us track down one of the best, we've enlisted the help of Jenny Gao, a food writer raised in Canada but born in Chengdu. She's taking us to a restaurant in the old part of the city that's due for redevelopment.
So this is the famous fly restaurant Ming Qing, and it started off just a couple of tables. But you know, as its popularity grew, more and more tables were added. It, you know, as you see, it spilled out onto the street.
Yes.
Called fly restaurants, apparently because of their rough and ready approach to hygiene, these places have always been the soul of the food culture here.
Fun to cook in this kitchen. It's just chaos.
Looks like,
so it's got chili garlic, bean paste.
Yeah, chili.
It's got some
paste,
garlic
and chili
and ginger.
Yeah.
What loads the fragrance?
Yes, the roar of the wok. How intense it is.
Yeah.
I'm desperate to cook with all these amazing spices, but first I want to taste how the chefs combine chili and Sichuan flower pepper to create the distinctive numbing heat they call ma la.
For all these dishes, you won't get like a very strong sensation of like, you know, very ma, very la. But eventually, after you start eating more and more, you start to feel
it.
I can feel it.
Feel it on your tongue and on your lips, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right. Yeah.
Oh, my mouth is on fire.
One of the most famous local dishes is Mapo Tofu, a regional classic made with tofu and usually ground beef or pork. But here at Ming Qing, it has a surprising alternative ingredient.
We're tricking you by putting in a little bit of pig brain in there as well.
Pig brain?
Pig brain.
Pig brains with tofu.
Yeah, dig in.
Despite my dad keeping pigs when I was young in Taiwan, I'd never developed the Chinese love of brains.
That's a generous bit of brain. Oh my God, goodness me. This is a first for me. I can clearly say I've had probably all bits of offal.
Yeah.
But not brain.
Not brain.
Feeling a bit funny, actually. Yeah.
Think of it as tofu.
Yeah, exactly.
Right, okay. It's really creamy.
It's yes.
Creamy.
It reminds me of like fragua.
Absolutely.
Pig brain is actually very popular in Sichuan, as is the brain of a lot of animals.
Yeah, I think I'll stick to the tofu.
Yeah, really?
Right.
Mapo tofu is one of my favorite dishes, and I really want to test out the authenticity of my version on the chefs at Ming Qing.
So I'm going to prep my ingredients here. So,
like many Sichuan recipes, garlic, ginger, chili bean paste, and of course a pinch of that ground Sichuan flower pepper are exploded in hot oil to release their fragrance. Like most of the dishes we'll cook on our travels, it's easy to do at home. It's a little unnerving though to have such an expert audience, particularly because I'm adapting the house special, swapping the pig's brains for Chinese long beans and pickled bamboo, although you could use leeks and shallots.
Yeah. In with my
beans.
In with the bamboo shoots. I'm going to season it now with a little bit of soy. In with the tofu.
That looks absolutely beautiful.
You can get ground Sichuan flower pepper in Chinese supermarkets in the UK or online. And don't be afraid to experiment to get that balance with the chilies just right.
Beautiful.
So I think we're good.
Very good.
Very good. Very good.
I love the atmosphere in this place, and it's heartening to see that traditional cooking is safe in the hands of these young chefs. And even though Ming Qing's present location is soon to be redeveloped, Chef Wu Jing and his staff are positive about the future.
he's going to just follow his boss, and wherever his boss opens next, that's where he will go.
Sichuan. Cheers.
The next morning, we've arranged to meet Jenny on the outskirts of the city. Chengdu is at the center of the government's Go West policy. It's invested $300 billion to spark an economic boom in Western China, on a par with Beijing and Shanghai.
Can you imagine this whole area? Most of these buildings were not here.
When I was here in 1989, it was still a fairly primitive place. Many of the streets were little more than dirt roads, and people brought produce in from the countryside on carts pulled by donkeys. Now, Chengdu has a population of 14 million and the fastest rate of urbanization in the world. In the next decade, it's expected to increase by nearly a million people every year.
There it is, that's the hotel.
Oh,
that's the hotel I stayed in. It was the tallest building in Chengdu. That's it. And you see now, it's dwarfed by all these other buildings.
Yes, and they keep building. Look how many cranes there are over there.
It's just amazing. I thought it would be a lot of change, but not sort of this much. It's shocking at the beginning because it's a sleepy backwaters here. You expect that from Shanghai and Beijing, but not from Chengdu.
Jenny's been kind enough to invite us to her grandparents' home, where she spent her early childhood.
My cousins and I used to come, and we would get together for family lunches, dumplings and noodles.
It's exciting for me, as I've always believed the best cooking is in the home. And a taste of family life is a great way to get beneath the skin of a city.
What is this? So these are my grandparents. My grandfather.
Jenny's grandparents are in their 80s, and as is traditional in Chinese culture, one of their sons lives at home and takes care of them with his wife, Jenny's aunt.
I love her hat.
Also, she says, My grandmother's
quite chilly, isn't it?
Yeah. So the reason why it's so cold indoors is because there's no central heating in Sichuan. South of the Yangtze, all of the provinces don't actually have central heating, because I guess the government figures it's not cold enough to need it.
So do they wear coats indoors then?
Yes, exactly.
And
in the winter, everyone wears coats, scarves, hats, the whole thing.
Thank God for the wok and cooking then.
While Ching gets to know the family, I really want to see the local market and join Jenny's aunt on her daily trip to buy fresh ingredients. Most days she's here at the crack of dawn to get the best produce. She spends around 5 hours each morning shopping and preparing lunch for her family. I offer to help out with a dish of my own.
More sausages.
And I'm on the lookout for inspiration. It's a struggle, though, to understand the local dialect.
So typical Chinese.
You're
embarrassed.
I've always loved markets, and in China, they're a particular pleasure. Chaotic. And despite the government's pledge to improve food safety, I can't see many fridges.
Oh, do you see this? The fish, see? Live. This is how Chinese want freshness. They want to make sure the fish is really fresh. Look at this fresh frogs.
This is fish, and there's sand fish in there.
Turtles, of course.
I spotted some rabbit, a specialty in Sichuan. The Chinese actually produce more rabbit than any other country, although they export most of it.
What they've done is quickly blanch it in hot water and they pull the skin off, which is how rabbit is done. You would not see this in Beijing or Guangzhou or anywhere I've been in China. I mean, duck, chicken, of course, you see that everywhere, but certainly not rabbit. And they just love it. It's a great protein, it's a sustainable food, and it was quite poor here, which is why they eat rabbit.
While Ken's at the market, Jenny's grandmother is showing me her traditional method for making pickles. She first adds to the pickling water, garlic, chili, and salt, and then uses a method I haven't seen before, two types of rock sugar, a lot of Sichuan pepper, and instead of vinegar, she's adding baijiu, a local 50% proof spirit, a bit like a sweeter version of vodka. Pickles are incredibly popular in China and are an easy way to preserve vegetables. When I was a child in Taiwan, I used to have them for breakfast with my grandmother. Jenny's grandmother always has a pot of pickles on the go, even today.
Oh, I can't wait to try this.
The pickling water is so strong that the vegetables are ready in just 24 hours. She serves them the traditional way, with a light drizzle of chili and Sichuan pepper oil, made from infusing hot oil with Sichuan peppercorns.
That is delicious.
So crunchy.
I've got now the chili, the numbing heat of that Sichuan pepper oil, and a little sour from the pickle.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful.
That's the beauty.
Thank
of
you. 谢谢奶奶.
As soon as we return, Jenny's aunt gets straight to work on the lunch. I'm making a simple rabbit stir fry, but you could use chicken for this dish. I'm using a marinade of soy sauce, sesame oil, with a coating of corn flour. It's usually best left for a couple of hours to take effect. I'm cooking the rabbit with garlic and the less spicy green chilies, as the flesh has a delicate flavor.
What people outside of China don't know is that even home cooks will heat the wok up until it's very, very hot before they add the oil. So I've heated it up for a few minutes now. This is good firepower. As you can see, it's smoking like this. Don't worry, you want this to be very hot.
You obviously have to be careful doing this at home. But if you pull the wok away from the heat, the flames will die down quickly.
This is the way, actually, you should be cooking it. This is what gives Chinese food its very, very special flavor. It seals in the juices. Now, it's very important is to take all this now and drain this. We add the garlic and the chilies. And instead of adding more oil, which is a mistake a lot of cooks make when they're not familiar with Chinese, we just add a little bit of this broth I made from the rabbit bones. And at the very end, I return the rabbit.
I'm only braising the rabbit meat for a couple of minutes. In the West, we usually aim for tenderness, but here people love chewy textures and really appreciate the feel of food in the mouth.
Very Sichuanese then.
While Ken cooks, I'm enjoying spending time with the family.
I feel like I've come back home. Yeah, it's great.
I grew up in a small village with my grandparents in rural Taiwan. And then, when I was 5, left with my parents for South Africa. Finally arriving in the UK when I was 11 years old.
When I was growing up at school, I was never proud to be Chinese. All I wanted to do was, you know, be English, and why can't I be more like my English friends, and wanted to dye my hair blonde and, you know, be very Western. Now, Jenny should come and try some 小吃.
Over the years, cooking has helped connect me to my Chinese roots. So it feels important to make something for Jenny's family that for them feels authentically Sichuanese. Watching Jenny's aunt cook is really inspiring.
She's making a boiled fish dish. Smells good. Mm-hmm. Your aunt is a really masterful cook. And she cooks in high heels. It's amazing.
I know.
it really is amazing. And so now she's sprinkling on the chili flakes. She's got some hot vegetable oil. Wow. That looks wonderful. I've never done it like that before. You know, sprinkle a dish with chilies and then just ladle hot sizzling oil on top. It's just, it's beautiful. It's really, I'm learning so much. It's wonderful.
I want to make a dish with traditional Sichuan flavors. I'm going to call it crispy, fragrant Sichuan sausage.
This is about experimenting. I do like to improvise sometimes because that's what I do at home.
First, I'm boiling some of Jenny's aunt's homemade sausages.
I mean, it is a Chinese cook's dream to have all these ingredients. But I'm going to use the woodier mushrooms because they're going to be lovely and crunchy.
Texture is always important in Chinese dishes, but if you like, you could use oyster mushrooms instead.
I've been pointed to these lovely pickled chilies. I'm going to keep the seeds because I know this family likes their food hot. Now, these look like spring onions or scallions, but they're actually suan miao, which is a garlic shoot.
The sausages should be ready after just 10 minutes of boiling.
Yeah, shape is important. It's all about presentation and also cooking techniques. Same applies for vegetables. If you cut them on the angle, you expose more surface area. They'll cook a lot quicker in the wok. In with the garlic, and then in with all the sausages. I'm going to wok fry the sausages first so they get a bit crisp. This is what my grandmother would do. Cook all the ingredients separately and then bring it all together. It takes a little bit more time, but it's going to hopefully be worth it. And I'm just going to add the vegetables in now. All of them together at the same time. You do need to be careful, otherwise you'll set your hair on fire.
The cooked vegetables are set aside, and then inspired by Jenny's aunt's fish dish, I'm making a kind of hot oil dressing based on chili bean paste and Sichuan flour pepper.
It's sour, it's spicy, it's hot, it's numbing heat. So what I'm going to do is just throw this all back into the wok and toss it all together so that all the flavours are mixed in really well. Okay. That is my crispy, fragrant Sichuan sausage with woodier mushrooms, garlic sheets and pickled chilli. And it's so hot. It's so numbing heat. This is a true Sichuan dish, I think. This is actually blow your head off good. I think I could give some of the fly restaurants a run for their money. Oh.
Jenny's aunt is treating us to the kind of feast the family only enjoys on special occasions. 30 or 40 years ago, they wouldn't have been able to afford so many meat and fish dishes. It's an amazing spread, including the water-boiled fish with its vibrant layers of hot oil, chili, and vegetables. Braised eel with green peppers. and a delicious, unusual stir-fry shredded potato.
This is better than any restaurant, I could tell you. Home-cooked food. God, this is pretty impressive.
With so much amazing, authentic food on the table, I hope I've pulled off a dish that delivers the right balance of spice and numbing heat.
I can have another drink now.
We're now 3 days into our stay in Chengdu. Our time with Jenny's family was a fascinating glimpse into home cooking. But the next morning, Ching and I are on the lookout for some authentic street food.
That's brilliant. That's just brilliant.
That's fresh chicken.
Western chains are moving in here. McDonald's has 28 outlets, and 7-Eleven are planning to open a staggering 350 shops in Chengdu over the next 5 years. Even so, we don't have to look far to find some delicious Chinese fast food, like these traditional baozi buns.
Should we get some popcorn?
Yes.
Made from steamed bread, they're an incredibly popular snack throughout all of China.
We saw in Beijing, they have their version. Everybody has their version. It's sort of like our sandwich.
Oh, it's just delicious. Mm.
In Cantonese, we only have the barbecue pork with no vegetables. Mm. And that was really nice. I took it to school. People were so envious. Yummy. They had these horrible, like, cold cut sandwiches, and I had this wonderful fragrant bao.
Have you ever heard of Starbucks? Starbucks Cafe Ting. Starbucks Cafe Ting.
Oh, she's unaware of it.
She says she's never heard of Starbucks.
Yeah. Even though China is modern, I don't think its food culture is in any way endangered by all these foreign fast food places, simply because there's a tradition of eating things like this.
Yeah.
The real threat to authentic food on the streets of Chengdu is the redevelopment sweeping through the city.
It's like a different planet.
Yeah.
They said China has half of the cranes in the world.
As the old neighborhoods are torn down, many of the street food stands have been moved here to Jinli Street, a purpose-built recreation of the old Chengdu.
So this is really modernized.
It's modernized, but it's okay.
Well, that looks good too.
Like, they all look
good. They all look good. Sichuan delicacy.
Yes, that's right.
It's a dessert, right?
It's glutinous sweet rice balls.
Uh-huh. It's called san da pao, three big bombs. It's to attract people to come, traditionally, the sound of it.
The theme park atmosphere seems to have done nothing to dent the Chinese enthusiasm for unusual and wonderful snacks. Like deep-fried rabbit's head.
Yeah.
Shall we try one? This is the rabbit head. Shall we try one?
No. Yeah. No.
I think we should try one. Come on. I want to try this because I've never tried it before.
8 baht. Okay. Yeah. So 8 yuan. That's like 80p.
It smells good. See, it's.
Oh, that's a proper skull over there.
Well, there's not much meat on it except for. The cheek.
Oh.
You know what it tastes like? It tastes like a little bit like a ham.
She's saying you should open this up. It like a crab claw.
Okay. Oh, I see.
To reveal the meat. All right, then. The seasoning and the spices on it
That's what makes it really
tasty,
good.
Tasty, aren't they?
Yes.
And it does make something that is sort of a bit gross to eat. Delicious.
That's cultural. If you grew up eating this, then it wouldn't be disgusting. Now, you know what Chinese used to find disgusting when Westerners eat big slabs of steak? They found that really disgusting. My mother used to recoil. She was like, oh, God.
How could he eat a big slab of cow like that?
Ken may be keen on rabbit's head, but I want to show him what everyone in the city is really eating. It's a food tradition that will never be threatened, however fast the city grows, and it's one of the national dishes of China. This fiery, bubbling cauldron of broth is known as hot pot. You can order pretty much anything you like, but the catch is you have to cook it yourself. This is China's fondue, except they've been eating hot pot for thousands of years.
Hello,
你好。这边就是制作过程，这边素菜、荤菜。
Bamboo shoots. It's fantastic how they slice it. There's no cooking here because all they do is prep, right?
Right.
Of course, this being Chengdu, they do a mean mala numbing heat version here, and I want to know exactly what goes into
it. They make all their soup bases. 你好。你好。
Look at that pot of Sichuan peppercorn.
Wow, that's a lot of flour pepper.
The copper hot pot is shaped like the yin and yang symbol to represent the balance of the mild broth on one side and the spicy on the other.
So they put in dried chilies, and then he puts in the flour Sichuan pepper.
There are many varieties of hot pot, but in this version, the yin side gets added flavor from a fish, tomatoes, and what looks like spam. It might seem a weird combination for Western tastes, but the buzz here is amazing. And it's clear that for the people of Chengdu, hot pot is just as important a social event as it is a meal. As if the hot pot wasn't already spicy enough, more stock and chili oil is brought to the table.
That's a lot of chili oil.
It's sealed in these bizarre clinical-looking bags, apparently to reassure the customer that the oil has not been recycled, a practice of some hot pot restaurants. But now that the government's beginning to crack down on food safety, reusing cooking oil has been banned.
It is making me hungry looking at the spicy red sauce.
It seems like we may have allowed the waitress to order too much food. But it was the heat from that lethal-looking broth that I really wanted to try.
It's not what I expected. It's not as spicy as I thought it would be.
Did you not taste the numbing heat? It's kind of like a delayed reaction.
It's a delayed reaction.
Yeah. It's really spicy.
Yeah, that's true. It's only when you say, oh, it's not hot, then you go, oh.
That numbing spice is really addictive.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
After suffering Chengdu's damp and foggy climate, I think I'm beginning to understand why everyone's obsessed with this unique combination of spices.
I mean, it's amazing. The first few days when I was here, I felt my bones creaking. I thought, my God, I feel old for the first time. And I noticed since I've been eating this kind of food, my joints did not sort of creak the way they did the first day.
The climate might be damp here, but it's contributed to the area around Chengdu being so fertile that Sichuan is known in China as the land of abundance. But it's not only crops, it also supplies over half the country's pork. My dad kept pigs when I was growing up, so I'm looking forward to visiting a local pig farmer. I'm hoping to try my hand at some traditional pork dishes. Mr. Peng is different to most farmers in the region because his pigs are organic. Nearly three-quarters of all the meat eaten in China is pork. To the Chinese, pigs symbolize virility, and traditionally, they've always been an important part of everyday life.
Wow, they're really hungry. Hello!
And although the Chinese eat every part of the pig, they still get through nearly 2 million every day. With so much pressure to churn out pork, organic farming has not been a priority. So I'm happy to discover Mr. Ping is obsessive about his pig's well-being. He produces and mixes his own feed and has a radical and unusual approach to their health. Mr. Peng's business started slowly, but in the last 5 years, due to food safety scares and the expanding middle class, the demand for organic food has quadrupled. He's invited me to his house to meet his wife and to have some supper. In return, I've offered to cook a dish for them. Mrs. Ping's prepared a whole selection of different cuts of their own pork, which she's boiled for 30 minutes. And before I cook, she wants to show me some classic home-style dishes. Starting with a much-prized cold salad.
It's funny, isn't it? Because back in England, pig's ear is probably the cheapest and people don't want that and actually discard it or make it into dog food. But here, it's really prized and the most expensive part.
Now she's got some baby spring onions. Before it can be eaten, the pig's ear salad needs to soak for a couple of hours in the spicy dressing, which is, of course, made with chilies and Sichuan flower pepper. From all the activity, it looks like I'm in for more than the simple supper I was expecting. With typical Chinese hospitality, Mrs. Peng is preparing us a feast using every part of the pig.
This is like a bridge pork rib. It's a really wonderful way of steaming here. So you just put water at the base and then put a plate over the top.
Their walks are amazing.
For her next dish, Mrs. Peng is making another local speciality, cherry pork made with soy sauce and a mix of caramelized sugar and a touch of vinegar.
It's juicy and really tender and very sweet.
I'm planning to cook my hosts a dish using more of that delicious pork belly, a Sichuan classic called twice cooked pork.
好，那我给你讲，你这样。什么地方都有，我主要是你先它，你先做的，一个是起来不成形。这样切。Mr.
and Mrs. Ping are clearly very particular about their food, and they both seem concerned that I won't stick to the traditional recipe.
不能乱切，包括成都、四川的任何地方的回锅肉，比较好吃的我都去吃过。好，就用这个做回锅肉。你们有一般的酱油吗？这就是酱油。
The light is used for seasoning, for saltiness, and then the dark is used for color, to caramel it. Now, there's so many different variations of hui guo rou. She likes to use the lao chou, which is the dark soy sauce. But I like to mix a little bit, the light and the dark. For my version of the dish, I'm starting with fermented black beans, mixing them with chili bean paste and frying the mixture in hot oil. Twice cooked pork is essentially a stir-fry dish, using slices of pork belly that have already been boiled for half an hour.
I'm just going to add a little bit of the dark soy sauce. and then a little bit of the light as well. A little bit of sugar.
The last ingredient in, as they only need a minute or so, are the spring onions.
Enjoy
this. Just a little
He's so proud of, you know, the Sichuan classic hui guo rou. This isn't even good enough for him.
He
said, it's okay.
不正宗.
It's salty, but it's not the real thing. But Mrs. Peng, she said it's good. Oh, 好厉害啊.
Mrs. Peng has made us so many classic Sichuan pork dishes, each using a different cooking method.
Doesn't it look amazing, all the dishes together?
不会做。
Penang, dressing on this pig's ear is really good. It's very crunchy. Cartilage. But good. This is Mr. Ping's daughter. Actually, I'm going to ask her what she thinks of my hui guo rou, my twice cooked pork. 你尝一下吧，我想看你觉得怎么样。好的，不错，好吃吗？嗯，好吃，好吃。 She said it's good. It's got good taste. At least someone likes it.
As well as pork and flower pepper, there's another locally produced ingredient that Sichuan has made famous, and defines the taste of the region. In the few days we've been here, everyone we've met has relied on it. If chili and Sichuan pepper are the heart of Sichuan food, then chili bean paste is the soul.
This is incredible.
Never seen anything like this in my life.
I feel like I'm walking into a cemetery or a monastery because it's so zen. It's a bit spooky and eerie.
At this factory in Pishan, just outside of Chengdu, they've been making the best chili bean paste in the world for over 300 years.
Oh, 2 years? This one's been aged for?
Wow,
they have 3 years and 5 years.
The paste is actually very simply made from just three ingredients: broad beans, red chilies, and salt. It's then left to ferment in these earthenware crocks for up to 5 years.
That is really superb.
It's beautiful. Mm. It's sour, spicy, beany, just really intense.
Yes. It's funny, I would never say this is chili bean sauce.
Absolutely, and it's never this color anyway. So that just means that they haven't been aged as long. The quality, Ken, that we've been cooking with has been substandard what we get back home.
The secret of this paste lies in the relentlessly damp Sichuan climate. The humidity in the air helps the years of fermentation, creating a chili bean paste unlike any other.
It's a little bit like wine. Mm. You know, when we do wine, we're talking about where the grapes come from, the terroir, what the French say.
Right. And
I think it's very much this, because this is the heart of what Sichuan cooking is about, this kind of damp, foggy climate that makes this kind of moody chili bean sauce that's the heart of this type of cooking.
Just as I'm beginning to relax, a stranger offers me the Chinese equivalent of a shoe shine.
Oh my God, he's got a little, he's got a little flashlight on his head. What does it feel like? Is it soothing?
It's,
It's not soothing, it's very interesting. Whoa, that is a sensation.
Oh, he's massaging your ears.
Oh, he's massaging my ear, I love it.
While the rituals of tea house life may remain unchanged, and where once I would have expected to see the gentle rhythm of Tai Chi, today people are moving to a different beat. The dancing reflects a newfound freedom that I hadn't sensed when I came here in 1989. Then China was still emerging from a period of long isolation and the trauma of the Cultural Revolution. Mao's attempt to impose communist ideas throughout the country in the 1960s and 70s resulted in chaos and famine. Every aspect of life was affected. Rationing was introduced, the art of cooking was abandoned, and many people fled the country.
Chef Li is a Cantonese executive chef.
People like Chef Li. He escaped to Hong Kong when he was 18, but returned to Chengdu 10 years ago as life began to improve.
Why did you go to Hong Kong? Because中國比較生活不太好，中國那時候有些游水的，你怕游水去香港，游水過去，真的。你游水過去？真的。真的？真的。哦，他游到香港，他游到幾久？游水游幾久？游水游幾久？很危險，那時候沒辦法，那時候要 為著去香港，都不怕死。Wow, that is amazing.
It feels good that Chef Li has returned to China. The influence of chefs like him has done so much to reinvigorate the food culture here. He agrees to give me a hand to make one of my favorite dishes, crispy aromatic duck.
What we do in the UK is we take the duck and we put things like five spices and Sichuan peppercorn on it and salt. But here is sort of the real thing.
For the dry marinade, it's okay to improvise the ingredients, but the base usually starts with salt and chicken stock powder.
And of course, we're in Sichuan, so you have chilies.
Lots of it.
And then, of course, the most important thing are these lovely Sichuan peppercorns, really quite powerful. He said, put it all in.
The rest of the marinade, including cardamom, ginger, fennel seeds, and bay leaves, are rubbed in. Then the duck is left for 3 hours to absorb the flavors. The trick to this dish is to steam the duck first for about 45 minutes, then to let it dry, and finally to deep fry it until the skin is crisp and golden.
Chinese like to gnaw on the bone because we feel that that's where all the flavor is. The marinade permeates the duck meat, and that's what makes it red. Absolutely beautiful. Out of this world. It's much more complex than the aromatic crispy duck that we get in the UK. And it's funny, you don't even taste sort of the chilies and things like that, but it's a very sophisticated mixture of flavors here. Outstanding.
Sichuan province may be one of China's culinary hotspots, but no trip here is complete without a visit to see Chengdu's most famous residents.
Oh my God, they're so funny. It's like they don't look real.
They're so human-like. I think any moment someone's gonna take the mask off and go, ta-da!
I love the one in the tree.
This panda sanctuary is home to most of the world's panda population. And here, at least, you feel that life will remain unchanged.
Yeah, this was worth the trip here.
Yeah.
Pandas are a massive draw for Chengdu, particularly for Chinese tourists. But we have one last place to go. It's a place where our experience of Sichuan food traditions are brought together and elevated to a new level.
Boy, I can't wait.
Yu's family kitchen is what...
你怎么会梦到就是想到这些这么美丽的食谱？没有，没有。你怎么会想说这么去做你的菜？应该说中国的传统的文化吧。
你不是只有会做传统，就是有做很多就是比较modern的，就是比较新代的，是从哪里去想的？你是怎么样？因为我经常就是到就是国外去交流吧。This feels like an incredible opportunity to try out some of the cooking techniques I've discovered here on one of the best chefs in China.
没有，没有，没有，我感觉为什么？
I want to use a traditional flavor combination unique to Sichuan.
It's called guai wei. It's called strange flavor. And actually, it's a combination of all these flavors, like the chili bean paste, some sesame paste, vinegar, sugar. You know, sort of all brought together. So we'll just see how
it's
it goes.
It's like a dressing.
It's like a dressing. Yeah,
it's
exactly.
Like a dressing.
I'm kind of nervous because all the chefs here work with such precision and my dish is a bit more rustic. My Guai Wei strange flavour salad will taste spicy, sour, sweet and nutty. It's a take on a Sichuan classic, smacked cucumber.
You just smash it just bruises it, it just starts to allow you to sort of put the flavours together, you know, absorb flavours of dressings. It's quite a local way of doing a salad.
I'm cutting the cucumber into large pieces, adding sliced mustard green hearts. Broccoli stems would work too. And some finely chopped garlic shoots to add at the end. For the dressing, the strange flavour sauce is actually a mix of icing sugar with black rice vinegar and light soy sauce. It's a sort of Chinese vinaigrette. To that, I'm adding some smooth peanut butter, which gives a lovely, rich, nutty flavour. And then sesame paste. The vegetables are tossed in the dressing and the garlic shoots sprinkled on top.
Laying the garlic shoots.
Finally, the key regional flavours. Sichuan flour pepper and chili bean paste, fried in hot oil to release the flavours. A trick I learned from Jenny's aunt, poured over the top.
So it's sort of hot and cold.
And to top it off, chili oil.
Boy, cucumber salad has never been the same.
And more ground Sichuan flour pepper.
奇怪的沙拉吧。
That is amazing.
可以吗？可以。
That looks lovely.
How sure. It's a nice, crunchy, refreshing texture. I expected it to be
more hot.
Yes, but it's not as hot as I thought it would be.
一般来说，豆瓣酱运用在沙拉上基本上没有的。这个就是我没有用过豆瓣酱这样的。 你的这种办法还是挺好的，是吗？真的，也告诉了我怎么样来做这一种。今天你告诉了我，我可能将来会这样做了。
He said, "Now that you've taught me, in future, I will definitely try."
Wow, 谢谢师傅。
Chengdu might be the fastest changing city in China, but our time here has been dominated by a sense of the traditional.
Before in the past, when I have come to China, I felt a little bit that I don't fit in. But this time, I feel a little bit more comfortable in my own skin. Cooking Chinese food, that's made me have a real deeper appreciation for Chinese culture. I could definitely envisage myself coming to Sichuan and spending a lot more time here, and especially in Chengdu.
The chef here has taken things on another level, and I think we're only seeing tip of the iceberg about what's really happening in China.
Next time.
Looks like an ancient medieval city.
It's really on the far fringes of China.
We'll explore a hidden side of China that feels distinctly un-Chinese. From the Wild West.
This is like stepping back 2,000 years.
To the tropical jungle.
Look at the chicken head.
There's some Chinese tradition I don't like.
And find out how China's race to modernity is affecting these ancient cultures.
Sort of a Chinese Disneyland.
Exploring China, a culinary adventure, is now available from BBC Books. And rich jungles beneath towering peaks next on BBC Two in Wild China.